right. Good morning, everybody. My name is Quinn Leslie, and my research question was, how did Sylvia Plath use form to create meaning? And if you'll notice that I passed out some poems for you guys to follow along while I read them. I'll be reading them in this presentation. Kyle, these are how numbers are supposed to be used. The letters are supposed to be used. Like, this is the correct way. So, before I start analyzing poetry, I want you all to shut your eyes, pretend that you're at a glowing lake. You're sitting on the edge of it. And the lake is so still that it's almost a mirror. And maybe it's glowing because the sun is rising. Maybe it's glowing because you're glowing. I remember I forgot what it felt like to breathe because I sat still for so long. Now you can open your eyes. And this moment that I had a while ago was when I discovered what poetry was. It's an exploration into the unknown. It's like why, when I felt like I had stopped breathing, the sunlight did it for me. So in order to improve my poetic writing and my understanding of poetry in general, I decided to focus on Sylvia Plath for my senior project. Now, reading Sylvia Plath feels like intruding on a deeply personal moment. And it's a kind of discomfort that makes me very curious. And for those of you who don't know, Sylvia Plath was a mother, a student, and a poet in the 1950s and 60s. And she was part of the House of the Confessionalists. And these poets started talking about taboo things like death and sex and depression until everybody thought they were insane, and they embraced this insanity as their public image. Now, what really intrigued me about the Confessionalists was how they were able to take such deep personal moments and make them applicable to any audience. And so I realized during my research that Sylvia Plath was an architect. She turned words into worlds using metaphors as a tool. Metaphors are wonderful because they take such specific relationships and you can apply them into the unthinkable. Think about how when you step out of your car and she grabs you and you're walking towards her kind of hesitantly, but without her you would fall down forward. This is the metaphor of walking into the wind head first, contextualized by a hug. Now, I'll read you a metaphor used by Sylvia Plath. My childhood landscape was not land, but the end of land, the cold, salt, running hills of the Atlantic. I sometimes think my vision of the sea is the clearest thing that I own. I pick it up, exile that I am, like the purple lucky stones I used to collect with a white ring all the way around, or the shell of a blue mussel with its rainbowy angels, fingernail interior. And in one wash of memory, the colors deepen and gleam, the early world draws breath. This is Plath's metaphor of a sunrise, contextualized by an ocean shell. She uses this metaphor to paint a picture in your head until you're breathing the ocean air next to Plath. She uses metaphors like this all the time to invite readers into her writing, but I more imagine that she's really old, maybe, can't remember anything. And she reads one of her poems, and she sees all of these little bookmarked metaphors, and all of a sudden she can sit with herself at the ocean again. I chose to analyze this piece, Ocean 1212W, in my research because its use of metaphor was so distinct. But this was only part of how Sylvia Plath created style. Her use of multidimensional layering to create a voice truly characterizes her work. I had a hard time finding a term to represent this idea, so I made up a term. It's called poetic ego. And poetic ego is used by Sylvia Plath in every single one of her poems. It's basically the poem's voice, the perspective, and the setting. Each voice embodies either a specific experience or a specific moment. And ultimately, each voice's point of view leads back to Plath's point of view. And by using poetic ego, Plath turned the personal narrative from a constraint into a tool. So I'll read you a piece that demonstrates how poetic ego creates meaning now, and that's your first slip of paper that I gave you. First frost, and I walk among the rose fruit, the marble toes of the Greek beauties you bought off Europe's relic heap, to sweeten your neck of the New York woods. Soon each white lady will be boarded up against the crackling climate. All morning, with smoking breath, the handyman has been draining the goldfish ponds. They collapse like lungs, the escaped water threading back filament by filament to the pure platonic table where it lives. The baby carp litter the mud like orange peel. 11 weeks and I know your estate so well I need hardly go out at all. A superhighway seals me off, trading their poisons. The north and southbound cars flatten the doped snakes to ribbon. In here, the grasses unload their griefs on my shoes. The woods creak and ache and the day forgets itself. I bend over this drained basin where the small fish flex as the mud freezes. They glitter like eyes and I collect them all. Morgue of old logs and old images, the lake opens and shuts, accepting them among its reflections. Now the first thing to note about this poem is its use of metaphor, because it's familiar. So the metaphor here could be found in the last sentence of the third stanza. A superhighway sealed me off, trading their poisons, the north and southbound cars flatten the dope snakes to ribbon. Now here, Plath writes a metaphor for the superhighway into her readers' brains. Her use of slithery, snaky imagery, combined with the metaphor for the superhighway, creates a specific view of it from the reader's brain. It is important to note that her linear and oversimplified metaphor is being used here to contextualize a complicated idea. Her imagery in the last line of the third stanza of Private Ground gives the reader's mind imaginative constraint until they're able to feel the exact same flavor of isolation that Sylvia Plath did when visiting her friend's country estate that inspired this poem. This effect of isolation is created through the use of metaphor. But that's not enough to understand this whole poem, so this is where poetic ego comes into play. It's obvious here that as the handyman with smoking breath has been draining the goldfish ponds, that the seasons are changing. This poetic ego is very old. Private Ground is the embodiment of Plath's lifelong experience of the changing seasons. Remember, poetic ego consists of three things. This ego setting is at the end of fall, or at the conjuncture of the equinoxes. This poem's voice are the natural processes that occur with the changing seasons. Living fish pools collapse like lungs, the escaped water threading back filament by filament to the pure platonic table where it lives. The voice here representing all of the changes in water that we take for granted, and when the earth tilts away from the sun, all of the water is forced to live in a frozen embodiment without a single drop promising a raging river. The voice speaks again as the baby carp litter the mud like orange peel, and represents death by the passage of the seasons. The final piece of this poem's ego is perspective, and this poem's perspective is also its meaning. This poem holds the point of view that humans, in perfect balance with the sun, reinforces the changing of the seasons. Even in her use of metaphor, Plath draws a parallel between flattening the dope snakes to ribbon and the handyman draining the goldfish ponds, because in both instances, people are the enforcers of impending death. This analysis and its unique framework provide a clear view of Private Ground's message. This poem is meant to provide the reader a small, isolated sanctuary from which to see the conjuncture of human processes and natural processes. This is done via metaphors that contextualize a feeling, forcing us to sit with Plath, and by using poetic ego to create meaning. I think that the most beautiful and simple example of the use of poetic ego and metaphor to create meaning is found in the poem Mushrooms, which is the other one that I gave you. And that one is annotated, so I'll read it out loud. Overnight, very whitely, discreetly, very quietly, our toes, our noses take hold on the loam, acquire the air. Nobody sees us, stops us, betrays us. The small grains make room. Soft fists insist on heaving the needles, the leafy bedding, even the paving. Our hammers, our rams, earless and eyeless, perfectly voiceless, widen the crannies, shoulder through holes. We diet on water, on crumbs of shadow. blind man are asking little or nothing. So many of us, we are shelves, we are tables, we are meek, we are edible. Nudgers and shovers, in spite of ourselves, our kind multiplies. We shall by morning inherit the earth, our foot's in the door. People think that this poem is about Plastori as a woman. They think that she's protesting. They think that Mushrooms is a piece about the tragedy of gender segregation. But they're wrong, and by using my analysis and my framework of analysis, I can prove that Mushrooms is about death. Let's begin by finding this poem's metaphor. I'm pretty sure I wrote it on your sheets for you. Mushrooms' metaphor is really obvious because it's actually the entire poem. The whole thing just characterizes mushrooms. So what's so special about mushrooms? Mushrooms exist in irony. They feed upon literal death to support their own lives. This entire poem is an extended metaphor for cyclical human life contextualized by mushrooms' relationship to death. Plath introduces us to deathly imagery in her first stanza, overnight, very whitely, discreetly, very quietly. And as the poem progresses, it's obvious as our toes, our noses, take hold on the lung, acquire the air, that death, that mushrooms represent the life cycle of a person. Mushrooms are alive in this poem, yet they depend on the natural process of death to continue living. Their lives cannot be separate from death, and because of this contradiction, death has the tendency to produce infinite life and vice versa. How is this poem speaking to you? What is its ego? Do you think it's a Capricorn, maybe an Aries? The first thing to note about this poem is that it presents itself as a we. This is its voice. The pronoun we is all-encompassing. This we is an individual collective of human death, contextualized by an organic metaphor. This poem's setting takes place over the course of a human life cycle. Death meekly creeps into our universe from a young age, yet slowly, as time progresses, we live with the face of our own death until suddenly we succumb. This is the poem's setting. It is the seedy passage of time as a small grain snake room. The poem's perspective comes from the relationships that mushrooms have with the natural world. These three pieces, the voice presenting itself as a we, the passage of human life, and the perspective of the decomposer, contextualized by the metaphor of mushrooms to represent the cyclical tendencies of human life, create meaning in Mushrooms by Sylvia Plath. Mushrooms is a documentation of the human condition. We preach about life after death when really the separation of life and death is an artificial one. We are a consequence of generation, and we are also afraid of the passage of time. The nature of the human condition is contradictory. Mushrooms by Sylvia Plath is a documentation of this contradiction. So basically, Sylvia Plath documented humanity in 11 stanzas. And so how on earth did she do that? And she did that by appealing to our ability to associate via metaphor and by inventing complicated poetic egos to speak for her. And after all my research, these two characteristics are what I have truly found to characterize Sylvia Plath's writing. So revolutions are always scandalous. And revolutionaries are always warped in the way that a carnival mirror warped my reflection and gave me nightmares. Sylvia Plath was perhaps the loudest, quiet revolutionary of the 1900s. And through the dissection of scrutiny, I have found an analytical framework that stays true to her writing and not her public image. With each poem and each piece of writing, Plath invites her readers to intensely specific moments, sometimes even taking entire paragraphs to document a millisecond of central information. Meticulous documentation of personal experience, magnified and projected through poetic ego, and contextualized by metaphors, is the defining trait of Plathian writing. As a writer, I'm blown away by Sylvia Plath. She was so committed to her words that they became sunsets, lifetimes, and suffering in just sentences. I'm so excited to continue my studies in the fields of poetic analysis, literary analysis, and writing. By taking lessons from Sylvia Plath, I have my foot in the door. Thank you.